So good morning and good afternoon. Welcome to my presentation, which is called The Inka Empire, What Innovations Can Provide Food and Water for Millions. My name is Dr. Isabel Hawkins. I'm an astronomer and project director. I work at a museum in San Francisco called the Exploratorium, and I am a consultant to the National Museum of the American Indian. Here's a picture of me with my family. I love this photo. This is my daughter, Mary Ellen, my daughter, Elizabeth, my husband, John, and myself. And I just wanted to share a little bit about my family and where I live. I live in California near San Francisco, but I was born in Córdoba, Argentina. I am bilingual, bicultural from South America. So my first language is Spanish. And I have been working on astronomy, also cultural astronomy, and trying to animate the cultural roots of science by working with Indigenous colleagues throughout the world. So our lesson today, the Inka Empire, what innovations can provide food and water for millions. I developed this lesson in collaboration with educators, curators, scientists, and Indigenous scholars at the National Museum of the American Indian. By traveling to the Andes, to Peru, South America, and working with knowledge holders locally. It is a lesson that highlights the importance of food sovereignty through water management and agriculture that are practiced in a sustainable fashion. Today, my dear colleague, Vilma Ortiz-Sanchez, is joining me to help out and manage the chat. She will also be the one who is putting the links on the chat for you to interact with later. And so thank you, Vilma, and welcome. So let's talk a little bit about the Inca Empire, which in their own language, the Inca themselves called Tahuantinsuyu. Tahuantinsuyu means four parts together or four regions together. A suyu is a region. In less than 100 years, from 1438 to 1533, the Inca built this massive empire, one of the most sophisticated in the world and with advanced both engineering and social infrastructure. You can see in this map of South America, this yellow region, this is the Inca Empire that really operated from 1200 to the mid-1500s AD, when the Spanish colonizers came and took over and disrupted just about every social structure and engineering prowess that the Inca had developed. You can see the extent of it. It's very massive. They developed a road system all the way from the contemporary countries of Colombia and Ecuador through Peru, Bolivia, all the way down to Chile and Argentina. This road called the Capagnan, or the Great Inca Road, spanned 40,000 kilometers or 25,000 miles. That is five times around the world along the equator, as you can imagine. It's just a massive feat of engineering for communication and also for redistribution of resources for the well-being of that community. My province is right there. That's Córdoba, Argentina. And so when I grew up, we used to go every summer to spend our time in a ranch that had no running water, no electricity, and everyone there spoke Quechua, the local people. So the Andean culture is part of the culture that I grew up with. I am not indigenous myself, but all the values that we espouse as our cultural values in Argentina are really grounded in Andean cosmology. Some of the language that we use, for example, comes from Quechua. And we still have friendships and collaborations with local indigenous people that were originally connected to the Inca Empire. So let's share with you a little bit about the lesson itself, since I know that you're eager to find out how you can implement all of this resources with your students, especially being an online lesson is perfect for now, for this time in which I really acknowledge that we're all going through a lot of challenges, but at least we have these opportunities to come together and learn about something new and something exciting for your students. So the grade level that the student, this lesson is geared for is for students of fifth through eighth grade. The subjects covered are geography, because of course the Andes has extreme geographies, all sorts of different natural environments. Also history, you know, it's important to talk about the history before the conquest and also what happened as a result of the conquest of the Spanish. So it gives you some historical context. Economics, you know, how the Inca were able to manage the resources sustainably, environmental science, and also STEM. And by STEM, I mean science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. You know, it is not often that we talk about native knowledge and indigenous well-being, indigenous ways of living within the context of science. Typically, we will talk about that in the context of social science. So this lesson, which takes about three class periods to complete, is tied to not only the social science standards, but also the national science education standards. And you can see the list right here. And in the lesson itself, it's very explicit as to which standards this lesson responds. So to set the stage for the lesson, we recommend that you ask your students, and we will do so ourselves here. We will watch a short video animation exploring the concepts of innovation and food sovereignty. So the lesson is designed in a C3 inquiry approach, in which there is a thematic exploration through various subject matters, but also through three questions that are supporting a compelling question. So the compelling question for this lesson is this one: what innovations can provide food and water for millions? And then your students will access a variety of resources. Many of them we will see here, including videos, interactives, which are really fun and engaging, primary sources, all sorts of imagery, quotes and interviews with Andean knowledge holders today. So accessing all of this information and resources, your students can then work in teams or individually to form an argument to be able to answer the compelling question. There is another lesson, a complementary lesson, called The Great Inca Road: How Can a Road System Be an Example of Innovation? That is the compelling question for that lesson. And they're both available in English and Spanish. And this complimentary lesson has a wonderful activity in which your students will actually build a model of this suspended bridge, which is the only surviving bridge from Inca times that is still rebuilt today in the Andes, using locally grown grass. And they make the rope, the women and grandparents, parents, the elders make the rope, and then the men will go down with these enormously heavy braided ropes to make the bridge. It is a wonderful lesson. I hope that you will consider it as well. Okay, let's dive in. So why do I show you this picture, which might be familiar to many of you? Of course, this is Machu Picchu, one of the most well-known ancestral sites in South America and in the world, and it is an Inca ancestral city. The reason why I show you this is just so that we can address it and then move on to the many, many other archaeological sites and towns and contemporary markets and activities that are still going on in the Andes, in addition to Machu Picchu. So if you're planning your trip post-pandemic to go to Peru, be sure that you give yourself ample time, because the Andes has a tremendous richness, both from the legacy of the Inca and the contemporary cultures today, which are mainly Quechua speakers and Aymara speakers. And also I wanted to point out that even as we see this beautiful city on top of this very rugged terrain, the greatest accomplishment of Machu Picchu is actually underground and unseen, because it has to do with water management and drainage. Because to be able to maintain a city in these conditions for 500 years, you really must develop a way to manage water in this environment in which you get torrential rains very often. So that is the beauty of the site, is not only just on top, but it's also recognizing what went on underneath. So to give you a sense of the power of water in this area, I'm going to show you this video that I took with my little iPhone at the side of the river. It's the Urubamba River, which skirts around Machu Picchu. And this is kind of a key moment for your students to say, how can you innovate to actually harness the power of water and utilize it for irrigation, for drinking, for all of the supporting the way of living that you want to have in a way that's sustainable and safe. So here's the power of water in the Urubamba River after the rainy season. As you can see, that was pretty that was pretty exciting, right? That was like, wow. You just look at that and you say, how is that possible that so much water can come down? And it's something that you're there, and I felt the vibration of the land caused by that raging river. So this other video is something that I want to share with you, which actually shows how from that kind of powerful moment of experiencing the water raging, we can also experience inside Machu Picchu the gentleness of spring water that was harnessed by the Inca to drink and to flow through a series of 16 fountains that are still operating today and are still giving us the purest spring water that you can ever imagine. So here's my colleague, Jesus Galeano Blanco, who is Quechua and is also a consultant to the NMAI. And we were there together in Machu Picchu, and we were filling our water bottles with the original spring that the Inca built and harnessed, having it flow through this beautiful 16 fountains. And now you can see that we're very happy drinking this delicious water, and the fountain itself is something to also admire. I actually followed all 16 fountains coming down the mountain and following the trickle of water. It was really amazing to see that this is still operating today. Okay, now my friend Vilma is going to show you a video animation, which is from the perspective of two middle school students, which will set the stage for the lesson.
What is quinoa? Maybe it's under Q. Do they have a Q section? Quinoa, quinoa.
What are you doing?
Looking for quinoa. My coach recommended it. Quinoa. By the rice or... I don't even know what quinoa is. What is quinoa?
The Inca had quinoa. Quinoa is a grain just like wheat. It contains amino acids like lysine. Also, calcium, phosphorus, and iron. It is high in protein and is tolerant to dry soil.
Hey, all that stuff you just said, well, except for the dry soil thing, that's the stuff that'll make me a good athlete.
Exactly. They also had corn, hundreds of different potatoes, fish, llamas, well, you can see the list. The Inca had a very healthy and diverse diet made possible by an innovative agricultural production and distribution system. The Inca practiced the art of agriculture, carrying it to remarkable heights.
Yes, of course, the art of agriculture. You know, this may require a little clarification.
Modern agriculture requires diversity of seeds, diversity of climates, and a reliable water source. The Inca had all three.
A little more clarification, please.
To grow a lot of stuff and to keep everything green, growing, and fresh, they modified the landscape with terracing, canals, and irrigation networks. The Inca engineered the most innovative water system in the Western Hemisphere, and much of that water system is still in use today. The Inca system provided water for personal use, agriculture, and also to control seasonal floods and soil erosion.
So, the Inca had plenty to eat.
Yes, but having plenty to eat was not enough. They had to get the food to the people. No small feat for a huge empire that was so big and diverse that it spanned four climate zones.
And when was this?
500 years ago. So, the Inca also engineered a road system that was the most extensive and advanced transportation system in the Americas, a 25,000-mile network. When you build something that big and complex, it takes a lot of time and effort.
So basically, an awesomely huge road.
And along with the road, the Inca developed a system of colcas. Colcas were warehouse for storage, preservation, and distribution. Colcas could hold many things, including fish, potatoes, corn, jerky. Colcas were built in the tens of thousands across the empire, arranged in neat rows and near population centers, large estates, and roadside stations. They were single-roomed stone buildings, usually round, but sometimes rectangular. The neat thing about it was that they even placed them in specific sites, like hillsides, so the cool breeze helped to preserve perishable foods and made them last longer.
So this is where I say the Inca had it all worked out.
Absolutely. The Inca engineered a modern, efficient system of water control, an innovative road system, farmed a diversity of healthy foods from many climates, and developed a long-term storage system. I'm not saying the Inca had it easy, but with innovation and engineering, they created a very secure and sustainable lifestyle that is still practiced by their descendants today. May I quote you? The Inca had it all worked out.
Yes! Hey, I think I found quinoa.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that, that video that gives you some of the background on the Inca Empire for the lesson. And now we're going to continue and actually delve into the details of the lesson. Who were the Inca? How did the Inca apply innovation to water management? And how did they apply innovation to agriculture are the three supporting questions in the lesson. The video gives you a bit of a background overall on who were the Inca, but there's an entire section that is divided onto three thematic approaches, geography, history, and ways of living, which also talk about the ways of living of the Inca, but also of Andean people today, their descendants. And so I think that your students will have plenty to actually research if their interest is more in the history or the geography, the natural environment, or what's going on today in the Andes. They can actually find a variety of resources to answer the question, who were the Inca? But now we're going to focus on the other two questions, water management and agriculture, because the theme today, of course, is food sovereignty. So let's go to the first of these two questions that we're going to answer today, or that we're going to address today in this lesson. How did the Inca apply innovation to water management? Here's an image of a very extensive stone canal that is of Inca design and of pre-colonial times that still brings water to a town in the valley called Tipon. But before getting to the inhabitants of the town today, this canal feeds an archaeological site called Tipon, which was a showcase of hydraulic engineering. So I'm going to show you a picture of Tipon. Here it is. Let me just find my better cursor now. If you will bear with me 1 second. There we go. The canal comes from way up in the mountains and even beyond. It spans several tens of kilometers, and the water comes down and it reaches both sides of this terracing infrastructure, which is the site of Tipon. And it also comes up here to this area where a lot of ritual for water and to honor water were conducted by the Inca rulers. So that's called Intihuatana. So the water would come down this terracing system and flow through a diversity of canals, both crisscrossing these areas where agriculture and a variety of foods would have been grown, as well as flowing down to the inhabitants of the town below, which are still living in Tipon today. In the website, there is an interactive for your students to use. You will probably see a link on the chat. You can engage with that interactive later on. You will see how through a strategic positioning of certain stones, the Inca were able to divert the flow of water depending on their needs. So it was a very exciting place to visit in addition to Machu Picchu. So So here, also, I wanted to showcase how that original engineering related to water management from the Inca times is still in use today in some towns in the Andes, particularly in this town of Ollantaytambo. You can see these amazing canals that are still providing water for the inhabitants, and the urban structure and design of this town is of Inca design and has been maintained for 500 years. When Vilma, my colleague Vilma, and I went there from the NMAI in 2015, we met this gentleman who was the mayor-elect of the town, and he introduced us to another gentleman called the Tomero, who is actually a water governor. And water is being managed through a system called AIMI, which is based on reciprocity. Everyone in the community contributes to the cleanup of the ditches, to making sure that the water is flowing. And if somebody takes too much water, they actually talk to that person and say, you can't do that. And if you continue to do that, we'll cut your water off. I've seen that happening in other towns that are even more traditional than Ollantaytambo. So the system of AINI is actually a system that balances the interaction in the community so that everyone can benefit from this vital fluid. The full interview with these gentlemen is available in the lesson plan for your students to research as primary sources. So now let's move on to the second question, which is, how did the Inca apply innovation to agriculture? I wanted to show this photograph of the Pisac ancestral site in the Sacred Valley of the Cusco region in Peru, because you can see the exquisite design of the terraces. And terraces is critical for two reasons. One is to extend the agricultural area, because when you have a lot of steep mountains, you want to really have flat land where to grow your crops. So by terracing, you actually are doing that. But once you terrace, you also stabilize the hill and you also manage the flow of water. So that is the purpose of the terraces. Today, there are more than 1 million terraces of Inca design still left in Peru and in other parts of the Andes. So now, with the help of my friend and my colleague Vilma, we're going to show you an interactive, which will show how particular the design of the Inca terrace is compared to European design. So here is the interactive, which you will see as a link on your chat as well. So first, we're going to start building. It's very simple to use, and you just push start building, and then you will be presented with a series of construction materials. So first, we're going to build it wrong. See what happens. Just topsy-turvy, put on the different materials in any order that you might imagine, and then see what happens once the rain starts to fall. So then you test your terrace to see how well you have constructed it. And here comes the rain, and whoops, looks like we didn't do it right. So we were not able to manage the flow of water. So now we're going to rebuild the terrace, but do it in the way that the Inca have built the terraces, which it's called a system of reverse drainage. And so it starts with large rocks at the bottom, followed by small rocks, followed by sand, and followed by topsoil. So if you build your terrace with the materials in this order, you actually are able to slow down the flow of water and stabilize the hill and irrigate your crops. So this is different, for example, from a French drain, which would have the large rocks on top. Because in the French drain in your backyard, you want the water to flow as quickly as possible away from your house, because you don't want the water in your house. So that's not the purpose of a French drain, slowing down the flow of water. You actually want, you want the water to go away. So let me share again my screen. There we go. So that's a really fun interactive. It's very engaging, and your students will be able to understand the principles of engineering of how it is that you choose these materials. And you can imagine that you could send your students home and say, okay, try different materials from your backyard and start pouring things in with your timer. I mean, they could invent their own experiments as well. So it's a really fun and motivating activity for them. So we're going to move on to another important principle of the innovation in agriculture of the Inca, which is food diversification. So the environment itself, like we saw in the video, there's four different ecological niches, ecological zones in the Andes. You have altitudes that span from 6,500 feet all the way to about 20,000 feet. So in all of these areas, all of these altitude areas, the Inca were able to plant and grow a variety of foods, like in here. From in the lower areas, you would have, for example, your round cotton, your corn, your beans, your prickly pear, and your pumpkin. And then over in the higher areas, now you're going to have your potatoes and your other tubers. And then up here, your camelids, which is the alpacas and the llamas and the vicuñas and the guanacos, would be a source of both meat and also be involved in llama caravans for transportation and trade. So this particular technique of utilizing all of these altitudes is called vertical agriculture. And it is a technique that allows, for example, an Inca farmer and even farmers today in one day to be able to harvest food from all of these regions. And then if you had, for example, drought in a certain area or you had a problem with pests, you would have many other ecological zones and areas to be able to go get your food. So this is an amazing way of making sure that they will, that the people in your community and in the empire would not go hungry. So that was the diagram. This is the real thing. So it looks like a bunch of terraces. This is actually called Colca Canyon, and Colca Canyon is twice the depth of the Grand Canyon. For those of you who have been to Arizona, I just want to point out that these right here, this little itty bitty dots, are cows. And so those cows, and then there's some more up here somewhere. Sorry, can see there's some right there. They're tiny, right? So you can see the scale of this canyon is quite impressive. So I'm gonna go back to my highlight here. So this is actually a living example of vertical agriculture. The Andean people today have thriving markets. This is a picture of the Pisac market in the Sacred Valley of the Cusco region. And you can see all of these varieties of potato. Today, farmers manage more than 5,000 varieties of potato. Just in the small town of Tawaititi, for example, at around 4,000 meters in altitude, the town has 500 people that manage 800 types of potato. And the food diversification is critical so that if something goes wrong with one particular type of potato or other crop, they can rely on many others. Here's a nice story that I will share with you with this crazy looking potato. This one is called the potato that makes women cry, and this is called the potato that makes men cry. And why is that? Because mothers-in-law will present these potatoes to prospective couples who are about to get married, and they will watch both the woman and the man try to peel this potato with a tiny knife as carefully as possible without any waste. And then they judge. If they pass, they can get married. If not, they have to wait a year. I witnessed this in a wedding in Cusco, and the mothers-in-law presented the potatoes to the couple. The woman did not pass. The man passed. And then the two women went back on their own and had their own private session and discussed whether they would let them marry. And then they came back and they decided, well, we're going to let you marry, but you have to practice, they told the woman. So, whew, they were able to get married. But it's a practice that really speaks to the importance and the respect of Andean people for food and making sure that nothing is wasted. In the Andes right now, they also manage more than 500 types of native corn, all the way from tiny ones, little balls that have tiny, tiny little seeds, and those are the ones that grow in the higher altitudes, to this giant seed type of corn to make cancha and other local foods that are very large cobs, and they have very large seeds. So here I want to show you the bounty again of a traditional meal that actually I ate the whole thing. Here's cuy, or the guinea pig that they have. This is seaweed and some fresh cheese, and this is caviar, I guess, from a fish, and potatoes. Oh, it's delicious. It's called chiriucho. So I ate that during one of my visits there. And you can see here in the market, the great variety of corn that they're showcasing, natural pigments. It's just a beautiful thing to be there. But how do you then preserve this bounty of food? We were traveling around the Andes and we saw this woman who was stepping on potatoes way up high. This was about 4,500 meters or almost 14,000 feet. She is a freeze-drying scientist, Doña Amalia. Meet her. When you think of freeze-drying, I always think of astronaut ice cream. You open it up, it's ugly and it looks really dry and chalky, but then you put it in your mouth and it hydrates and all of a sudden you have ice cream in your mouth. Well, that's exactly the technique that these farmers in the Andes invented 500 years ago. And they create what is called chuño, which is the black potato freeze-dried, and moraya, which is the lighter potato freeze-dried. And the chuño, for example, which is the drier one that actually feels like a rock, very light though, because it has no water, but it's hard as a rock. This can last for more than 10 years if it's stored in a dry place. And then to be able to hydrate it, you soak it for several days, and then you can incorporate it in your soups and stews. So this technique is really amazing. Why does it work up in the high altitudes? Because the atmospheric pressure is very low. And so basically the water in the potato will actually transform during the freezing nights and the warm days from ice directly to a gaseous state. So the water does not evaporate, it sublimates. And that creates the freeze drying process without having to have a vacuum tank, which is what happens at sea level. So the Andean farmers invented this amazing technique and they still use it today. We had a lot of fun with Doña Amalia, who is a Quechua speaker, but we were fortunate to have my friend, Vicky Galeano Blanco, who's an archaeologist, and she's also Quechua and speaks her language. We were accompanied by a Mayan grandmother who also works with the NMII at certain workshops. And myself here, we just had a lot of time speaking in so many different languages. We had Spanish, there was someone else in there who spoke English. We had Quechua, we had Yucatec Mayan. It was a wonderful afternoon learning from this freeze-dried scientist. But now that you have your freeze-dried potatoes, the Inca also designed a system of storage and distribution called colca. You saw that in the original video that we saw, the introductory video. But now we have an actual colca video that we're going to show you that speaks to the amazing redistribution infrastructure that the Inca had set up. So Vilma, can we see that video?
Colca es depósito para guardar alimentos. Hay depósitos de todo. Depósitos de tejidos, depósitos de herramientas, depósitos de armas, depósitos de carne también. Las colcas servían para todo. Entonces había una cierta forma de redistribución.
Ahora estamos en el interior de una colca. En la puerta, ligeramente trapezoidal, bien conservado. Y esto da idea de la dimensión de una colca. ¿Para qué almacenaban tan productos o ropa o armas? Era precisamente para redistribuir a su población. Después de las cosechas, llegaban productos del área y de fuera del área también, entonces el Estado, el Inca o su representante, la autoridad delegada, redistribuía los productos internos. Entonces, la gente se sentía feliz.
So colca were an essential component of sustainable agriculture and redistribution in the Inca Empire. And here's an image that shows many, many colcas. They actually had colca centers for storage and distribution throughout the whole empire. By the millions, they had millions of colcas distributed throughout that large Tahuantinsuyu that we saw the image and that yellow zone in the South America map at the beginning of the presentation. So colcas were thriving at the time of the invasion of the Spaniards. But the colonial pressures and abuses, they destroyed that system. So it's no longer in operation today. On the other hand, the concept of aini, which operates more at the community level, which is reciprocity, that is still very much thriving in the Andean communities today. So the colca centers were thriving before, and unfortunately, 500 years ago when the Spaniards arrived, they destroyed the whole system. Let me just go back to here. Okay, so now we're gonna switch gears a little bit because I'm an astronomer, I can't help myself. So I wanna share with you a little bit about Inca astronomy, which is very different from the astronomy that we learn about in our schools. We typically learn about constellations from the Greek perspective, in which we might see a shape in the sky by, you know, tying or connecting the dots between bright stars in the night sky. But in the South American Milky Way, particularly our galaxy, when it crosses the sky, the most prominent feature of the Milky Way is actually dark clouds, which are dark molecular clouds through which starlight from the background cannot get through. And so those dark clouds form shapes that, again, in our human imagination, we can connect with our way of living here on Earth. And the Andean people to this day still connect the dark shapes in the Milky Way to, for example, camelids. You can find a llama in the sky, a mama llama and a baby llama suckling. You can find a fox trying to eat, here's the eyes of the fox, trying to eat the feet of, or grab the feet of the baby llama. Here's a herder, here's a partridge, here's a snake. So all of the animals that live on Earth are also reflected in the sky. And of course, knowledge of the sky is not just folklore or storytelling, important as that is. It is for the purpose of calendaring, for the using the mathematical precision of understanding the cycles of the stars to be able to time planting and harvesting. So even today, Andean people use this cluster of stars called the Pleiades to be able to time precisely the timing of the potato, when the potato has to go in the ground, because the Pleiades, when it rises up in the horizon in the east before sunrise, that will happen in June, you can actually see whether the stars appear blurry or crystal clear. And that is an indication of what El Niño or La Niña currents are happening in the equator, in the equatorial region of the Pacific Ocean. Can you imagine that? And the Andean people today can actually discern the difference. And if the is crystal clear, they can plant the potatoes early because the rain will come on time. If it's blurry, that means that the rain's going to be delayed and they have to wait up to 2 or 3 weeks to plant the potato. And those 2 weeks are critical because potato has a root system that's very sensitive to early rain, and it can either die or thrive depending on how precisely you time it with water. Of course, climate change is creating chaos everywhere in the world, so that technique is being adjusted by indigenous people as we speak. Here's, I want to show you this last video of this gentleman who told us about his knowledge of the Pleiades. So he will be speaking in Quechua. I just want you to hear the language and I want you to try to identify two key words. One is chasca, which means star, and the other is koto, which means Pleiades. So we're going to go back and interview him. I'm also a Fulbright scholar, and as part of my Fulbright fellowship, I will spend 2 months in Peru, hopefully by the end of next year. And we promised him that we would come back and fully sit down with him and spend time, and also ask him how he would like the result of this work to benefit his community. You know, perhaps we could develop some books together or engage some of the youth to reconnect with the knowledge of the stars, and so that we can give back to the community. To wrap it all up for your students, after they have considered these three supporting questions and looked at all the evidence and try and come up with their argument to answer the compelling question, what innovations can provide food and water for millions, we provide an interactive tool to help your students make their case for innovation. And they actually write a news article based on everything they've learned called the Andean Messenger. And it's an interactive tool that presents the students with an opportunity to put in their a title for their article, who their byline. They write an essay to make the case for innovation. They select up to three images, writing captions, and also they can select quotes and other resources to feature in their article. So here's my article. I was very pithy in my essay. I just said the Inca were innovative engineers, but I chose these images. And here's a quote from one of the water governors. So your students can also have fun showcasing their knowledge through this interactive tool. So I want to leave you with just the thoughts that, to me, the most important key messages for your students to walk away with is that Inca engineering was pervasive, that it was well interconnected, and that it allowed millions of people to thrive in very harsh environments in the Andes, and that those traditions and knowledge system still continues today and is being applied for the well-being of Andean communities that are Quechua speakers and Aymara speakers in the Andes. So that is my parting wish for all of you, and I hope you will be very well this afternoon. I want to end with a quote by our keynote speaker, Wynonna LaDuc. Wasn't that an amazing presentation by our keynote speaker? I loved her video. But she said something that really stuck in my heart, which is, let's get local and use Indigenous knowledge. But I also wanted to share that when we say use Indigenous knowledge, if we are not Indigenous ourselves, we have to be very conscious that the using needs to be by and for Indigenous people and their communities to help heal the planet. And then for all of us, practicing our generosity, living in balance with nature, and deepening our relationship to the earth will benefit us all. Finally, I would like to thank all these amazing curators and knowledge holders, both at the NMAI and in Peru, who worked with me and are my dearest friends and colleagues, including this lovely little llama at Machu Picchu, so that we could learn from the land and learn from the people in the Andes who so generously gave of their time and resources to meet with us. Thank you so much. Sulpaki.